Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Samuel Adams Returns. Those anti-federalists, they got it so right. I mean, I have to just take in and just get it really expressive with the fact that those anti-federalists, they did. They got it right. And this is Tom Novolis, your host, and I am so delighted that you are back here with us today. And wow. You know, when you look at the promo, I titled this program The Tale of Despotism. The Tale of Despotism. And I didn't say a whole lot on any of the programs till now, because you know you always got to watch and see all those various things that are going to happen. But you know, we can take that Tale of Despotism and then go with it to say the Trail of Tyranny. So you got it, that despotism comes into place, and then the next thing you see is that walking off into the whole idea of tyranny. Very, very interesting. And in private conversations prior to the inauguration, I made the statements to folks and said, yeah, give it that first week and we will be so far down the path of communism that it will be interesting to see how we recover. Oh, Tom, what are you talking about? How can you say down the path of communism? You know, it's just the socialists that are there. Well, you know, I'm preaching to the choir here, so I know the majority of you at Liberty Works Radio Network, at Dr. Mike's programming as well, what we have with all our Screaming Eagles in Lima, even a lot of those folks, hey, you folks over in England that listen to the podcast, you know, it's you're seeing you've had socialism in England for decades. You know, let's think about all of the folks with the Fabians and all of that, you know, really started there. And I mean, England even hosted Karl Marx and Engels and all of that for a good period of time. So, you know, you've had those seeds and activities happening there. And to the extent, quite a difference between parliamentary forms of government and our constitutional form of government. And when we consider that tale of despotism, we always have to go back and review what I suggested, that people understand the Kozak plan. And you know, again, you know, a couple programs ago, you know, I suggested to you to go ahead and do a search at where samueladamsreturns.net, so that you can look up all that I've talked about regarding the Kozak plan, and that you could download or at least find the PDF that outlines it, that discusses it. The problem, as we saw over many years, as the socialist, communist, the globalist, since again, the turn of the century, and not the 21st century, but of the 20th, from the 19th to the 20th century, what we saw was that plan, that working, that trail being laid out, over a 100-year plan that was being put into place. And the problem within the context of a constitutional takeover of America, I'm going to give you a secret. You ready for the secret? I'm looking at Kath. I'm looking at you that are watching on the video. Here's the secret. I'm getting close to the mic so that I can whisper in it. The secret is that our Constitution, being a covenant with we the people, is also what? Under federalism. And under federalism, what that means is that the states, and especially within the context of the Bill of Rights, We have the 9th and the 10th Amendments.
Whoa, what are those?
Well, even before that, we're going to talk about that in today's program. We're going to talk about somewhere in these next, probably in the second and third segments of the program, we'll talk about the intrusion and how the anti-federalists looked at that intrusion in respect to the federal government. And you've heard me talk about it, and Brutus and a few others who predicted that the federal government, ladies, was going to get into your boudoir, and they were going to even look at your toiletries. And I used to use that in the Agenda 21 stuff, but no! Look at, here it is, go look it up. I'm not going to put it up there, and I didn't put it into reference. Kath and I were talking about this. Go look at all of your items in your bathrooms, ladies, that are ding, made from oil. Boing! You have a hair clip. Do you have a comb? What about your brush? Hey, what about your bra? What about your other clothes? Jeez. Hey, what are you going to wear? What are you going to wear? All of our cotton is shipped overseas. Do you realize that we really have no mills here in America for cotton anymore? There's only a couple places in the U.S. that even take and make, what's that stuff that we use for jeans? The material for that? Cotton cloth is not made in America except for two places in the whole United States. And they do, you know, small runs. I mean, they make runs of what they can, but they can't keep up with keeping your bare bottoms covered. Interesting. Yeah. At one time, I was working with a company, and we went down to Costa Rica, for example, when all of our textile mills left the United States, left out of Georgia, left out of the South, and went to Costa Rica, went to Central America. When I went down there looking for some other reasons and doing some trade negotiations, it was interesting. The Minister of Trade for Costa Rica took us around to all these different mills that are empty, full of equipment, because as cheap as it was to manufacture goods, manufacture clothes, manufacture cloth in Costa Rica, it was cheaper to do it with the slave labor in China. So here you have, you know, you want to start up something down there. If you can get the raw materials to Costa Rica, you can start up a whole manufacturing operation down there. And anyway, we'll see where that goes. But the point is that we just saw despotism in action in the course of a week. And that's what I predicted. I predicted by that first Saturday that we would see that despotism moving fast towards an aspect of tyranny. So we have the tale of despotism with what occurred and with an administration that is coming in that is communist, globalist, and with that, as of this past Wednesday, with all the additional executive orders, we are now mapping through that road of tyranny. So this is the tale of despotism with the trail of tyranny, which will be the trail of tears. Now, what I also want to briefly kind of close out this first segment with in these last few minutes, last 5 minutes, is something that I want you to consider relative to this nonsense of impeachment that has been delivered to the Senate and what the Senate is doing. So, you know, I pull out my handy trusty five volumes of the Founders' Constitution, and you start digging through in volume one, and then you have to go into also volumes two and three to take and extrapolate everything. But here's where you're going to be smarter than over half, because you're going to include the five Republican senators that voted with the demons to take and have a trial. Here's where you're going to be smarter than over half of the Senate. So this comes out of, as much as I don't like the Federalists, especially Alexander Hamilton, I have to say that when I also look at a lot of things, and not to belabor it because we want to get going, is that the Federalist number 65, Hamilton has this to say, which is very, very interesting. And this was in March of 1788. He says, a well-constituted court for the trial of impeachments is an object not more to be desired than difficult to be obtained in a government wholly elective. The subjects of its jurisdiction are those offenses which proceed from the misconduct of public men, or in other words, from the abuse or violation of some public trust. They are of a nature which may, with peculiar propriety, be denominated political, as the relate chiefly to the injuries done immediately to the society itself. The prosecution of them, for this reason, will seldom fail to agitate the passions of the whole community and to divide it into parties more or less friendly or inimical to the accused. In many cases, it will connect itself with the pre-existing factions and will enlist all their animosities, partialities, influence, and interest on one side or on the other. And in such cases, there will always be the greatest danger that the decision will be regulated more by the comparative strength of the parties than by the real demonstration of innocence or guilt. There you go. You are now, all the listeners of Samuel Adams Returns, the Anti-Federalist, got it right, giving credit to a Federalist in Federalist 65, saying that this is politically motivated and there is nothing in it, because the charges which are being laid by the House of Representatives are not anything that falls in line even with the Federalist Papers, let alone the Anti-Federalist, and it takes you thousands of pages to go through and understand what does it mean to take and hear our foundational principles. But you see, Sam Adams knew all of that. He talked about it. So did the Anti-Federalist. And you know what? I'm so delighted that I can kind of even find these things, which are in the references for you to look at yourself, and as well as, you know, Chief Justice Story and a whole number of other references that allow you to understand that this is all a bunch of baloney and that we need to pursue liberty as we can within the context of the structure of our covenant and in detail with the states in which we live. So I'm going to be talking about the importance of taking back the republic of your state, wherever it is you live, because that's where Sam Adams was focused, the anti-federalists were. And you know what? We'll come back into the next couple of segments to discuss this even more. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back again to Samuel Adams Returns, Those Anti-Federalists. As we just proved, even a Federalist chimed in a way that matters. And be it all, it was Alexander Hamilton. But yes, the Anti-Federalists did get it right. This is Tom Navolas, and I just want you to take a look at what's going on at Liberty Works Radio Network, because there is so much happening, some great live programming, as I always let you know. And then, you know, on weekends like what we're doing now, there's good programming as well. Hey, I'm here on the weekend three time slots. First time slots on Fridays. Go check it out and see either on my page at libertyworksradionetwork.com or lwrn.net. And then I am at 9 o'clock Saturday morning and again at 7 p.m. So you have three opportunities to hear this program. And if you miss something in Friday night, you can always listen to me twice on Saturday. I mean, you know, how much better does that get? But everything is archived at samueladamsreturns.net. The podcasts are there. And the video of my smiling face engaging with you, talking with my hands, and so on and so forth. We have a lot of fun. You know, with that, always, please find that donate button. As much as people are taking and coming after you for money from every direction, please do donate to Liberty Works Radio Network, and we will have something else to tell you specifically about Samuel Adams Returns in the third segment. So with that, I want to just kind of pick up where we left off just for a little bit in respect to what we have here out of Federalist 65 and what Alexander Hamilton was talking about when he identified that the potentials for the impeachment would be political. The real question is there any real injury done immediately to society itself that makes it impeachable? Was there a real crime committed, not a bogus created crime? Because we know, and now it's coming out all over the place, which they'll never admit to, is Nancy Pelosi, the FBI, and all the others knew that there were going to be problems. And if when people get taken to court, you're going to see a lot of people that have video of none other than the Capitol Police inviting them inside the Capitol. So we do have some bad actors that were involved in that, but let's face it, it was not anything that the president did to take and bring up insurrection, because the president wasn't doing that. Everybody had a right to redress, and that's what the socialist, communist, democrats don't want you to understand. You have a right to redress. A lot of you do. Otherwise, you wouldn't have shown up as you did there. So let's finish a little bit here with Federalist 65 before we get off into other things. So the convention. So here's where Hamilton goes back to the root of the Constitution. The convention, it appears, thought the Senate the most fit depositary of this important trust, that being impeachment. Those who can best discern the intricate difficulty of the thing will be least hasty in condemning that opinion, and will be most inclined to allow due weight to the arguments which may be supposed to have produced it. So instead of having this being a fit depository, the Senate is a kangaroo court. It was the first time, and it continues on to be that, except for some people that fit more of this. What it may be asked is the true spirit of the institution itself. It is not designed, get this, it is not designed as a method of national inquest into the conduct of public men. And that's what the kangaroo court is, that's happening, that has happened under the Democrats from the House into the Senate. And boy, I'll tell you, I don't lay it all on the Democrats. I got to say that outstanding Republican Mittens, Romney, is there at the front of it all. So let's continue here. If this be the design of it, to be a national inquest, is where this paragraph is going. If this be the design of it, who can so properly be the inquisitors for the nation as the representatives of the nation themselves? That's who it is, the electorate, you, the people. That's what he's saying here. It is you, the people, that if you're going to look at a national inquisition, it's all about you taking a look. It is not disputed that the power of originating the inquiry, or in other words, of preferring the impeachment, ought to be lodged in the hands of one branch of the legislative body. Will not the reasons which indicate the propriety of this arrangement strongly plead for an admission of the other branch of the body to share in the inquiry? The model from which the idea of this institution has been borrowed pointed out that the course to the convention in Great Britain, it is the province of the House of Commons to prefer the impeachment and of the House of Lords to decide upon it. Several of the state constitutions have followed the example, as well as the latter as the former seem to have regarded the practice of impeachments as a bridle in the hands of the legislative body upon the executive servants of the government. Is not this the true light in which it ought to be regarded? And then it goes into, where else than in the Senate could have been found a tribunal sufficiently dignified? Oh, the Senate being dignified, oh my, or sufficiently independent. The Senate being independent, when we talked about a political party at the first paragraph? I'm sorry. Anyway, what other body would be likely to feel confidence enough in its own situation to preserve unawed and uninfluenced the necessary impartiality between an individual accused and the representatives of the people, his accuser? I'm going to leave it with that. You know, go read Federalist number 65. I think it's more gets into relationship to the courts and why isn't that the Supreme Court, you know, can't be the tribunal that would actually do the judging, so on and so forth. And I want to get into all that detail of that, but it's critical to understand. And I'm going to give you the Tommy 2021 summary, is that we've been in this long march to establish this despotism. And as I was closing out in the last segment, the important aspect of that was in relationship to the Kozak plan and the difference between that which is part of the parliamentary system versus a constitutional system, with us being a republic, a small r republican form of government, where the states come together within the context of a federal union, a federal covenant, as well as then the federal government not having all of its authority over the states. So we got a problem here, Vern. Yes, we have a problem. And the problem we'll talk about a little bit in this segment and then move on into the third segment is that intrusion, which was predicted by the anti-federalists as that of consolidating all of our federal government into a national infrastructure. So what was the 100-plus-year plan that we looked at from Kozak? And you have to remember, Czechoslovakia had a parliamentary form of government. And to that, it was much easier to take over a parliamentary form of government and to subsume it and centralize and get the communists elected into that parliament in such a manner that then they would bring in the dictator. Wow. So now we have the dictator in America under what happened in our elections. And again, they were faux elections. They were fake. They were fraudulent in so many different ways. So what we have to look at is based under our form of constitutional government, they have to move fast. So that's why I say the trail to tyranny. And we have to look at that because what we have is the tale of despotism, which I've talked to you for these last 5 years, is the tale, it coming about. Nah, what's going to happen? So we were doing that in a way by looking at the past and what was able to be predicted by the anti-federalists for our awareness so that we wouldn't get today. But, you know, we allowed it to happen. And I will put a plug in here. I know, Kath, I'm beating that dead horse back in the woods. And there's not really a dead horse in my woods. So don't take that out of context. But beating that dead horse in the conversation, it is very clear that the Federalists expected the churches to do their job and produce what I discussed or what was preached in the sermon that is posted up here on what is the expectation of the magistrates by God, which you don't know that, and the modern magistrates do not know that unless what? It was preached from the pulpits. So we're here today because the pulpits did not follow through on the expectation of the Federalists so that we would have a moral and virtuous people, whereby we would have moral and virtuous representatives in government, local, state, and federal. There's a few, but not many. So how much easier then is it to execute then on that plan when you don't have a moral and virtuous people that understand the laws of nature and nature's God to the extent that when they go to office, when they go to work on establishing law, that they would be moral laws in the context of what it would mean from that biblical or from a very principled format. Instead, we are legislating immorality, or morality of one nature or the other, and it happens to be now immorality when you plainly look at this new administration. The new administration, when you have a pseudo-man that shows up in a way that is insulting to both men and women. And you know what? I'm sorry. That is a sinful composition, as well as the other sinful compositions that are coming in the form of tyranny. And that tyranny now is from the Department of Homeland Security that has all this power to search for domestic terrorists. That means me and Kath and all of you that are listening to this program, anybody that has supported Donald Trump in any form, and to the extent as AOC has now declared, every Republican is a terrorist. Well, she used different terms, but, you know, under the Homeland Security edict that just came out this week, go think about it. So not that I'm trying to raise up a lot of stuff, but these are the same things that the anti-federalists talked about as the incursions into our liberties if we did not have a moral society. And that's exactly what Sam Adams discussed as well. and the Anti-Federalist and all the various writings. And we're going to go to the Anti-Federalist in the next segment. So come on back for the third segment as we kind of jump back into those Anti-Federalists getting it right. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to this third segment of Samuel Adams Returns Those Anti-Federalists. They did. They got it right. And this is Tom Navolis, your host. And, you know, okay, I calmed down after the break. Oh, I wasn't all riled up anyway. Kath is laughing at me, you know, so, you know, it's always that fun. But most of all, hey, all you screaming eagles out there, welcome back to this third segment. And if you wanted to hear that little bit of a riled up, you got to go back and download the podcast or watch the video. There you're at. You can get it all at SamuelAdamsReturns.net. And, yep, that's where you can take and see, did I really, or hear, did I really get riled up in that second segment? But there was a lot put out, a lot that we talked about in relationship to more on Hamilton with Federalist, what, 65? Yeah, 65. And some of the other ideas that we talked about on the Kozak plan and what did that mean, some of those differences and all of that. So what I want to touch on with you here now in this final segment is the idea that, first off, there are more things that we want to do with Samuel Adams. So once again, we're not a 501c3, so we can virtually say anything within truth that needs to be said and support all that we can support, but we can't support anything because we don't have any money to support anything. Again, you know, Kath and I are doing this. So with that, we are trying to work our way into that whole idea of what does it mean to do a man in the street type of a vlog, that's a video blog. But we need some help. Please contact us. Send a, you'll find the email at SamuelAdamsReturns.net for me. And we can help you understand how you can contribute. Because what you'll get for contributing is really a book, a video, you know, some other type of work that I've done. Because we have a number of different videos on Sam Adams. And, you know, you get something for your money. With that, let's move on to talking about where I left off in the last segment. That second segment, I left off talking about the intrusions that were predicted by the federal government. And more so, the way that we look at that is not as much from intrusion, but the way that they said it is interference. Now, the intrusion of the federal government, we're seeing as that despotism, it moves from the tale of despotism to the trail of tyranny. And the trail of tyranny is that which will take and leave disaster, hurt, and pain all along its path. We saw and we see it even more now with, you need to double mask. And that's coming from somebody that's making almost $500,000 a year, the most highest paid bureaucrat in the whole U.S. government. Hey, I have some fun on this program. You know, I'm just not a sullen individual. So double mask, that in itself has its own form of tyranny laid into it. It is despotism from a federal level perspective, and then it's enjoyed by the various governors that are out there in our 50 states. Or is it by virtue of some of those out there that we have 53 states? Because now we're considering Puerto Rico, and we're also considering the unconstitutional move of taking and bringing in none other than Washington, D.C. to be a state. And you know, we'll create something else. Maybe St. Thomas will become a state. Who knows? Anyway, the idea of intrusion moves to interference. And from the Anti-Federalist, the Observer, when he's talking about what is going on and the disadvantages and the pains that will come from this constitution. And if we look at what it means to bring this together under the proposed constitution with the federal government taking and overreaching everything, we looked at the Confederacy not being that which is holds into its pluralisms, but into the fact that it will be a consolidated form of government where the controls over the nation relative to what should be external matters only. So the federal government should reach to the external matters only and not interfere with the internal regulations and policies of the different states in the union. Such a government, while it would give us respectability abroad, would not encroach upon or subvert our liberties at home. That would be a good constitution. That would be a good government. Whereas what we're seeing now, with all the pieces put in place, with all the executive orders signed over the last week, that what we're going to see is an encroachment, the interference of internal regulations and policies of the various states in the union, and that's already happening in so many different policy ways at the federal level because they have stolen our money and are trickling it back down to us through the states and through the governors. And so even our respectability abroad is now, just in this first week, is deteriorating, except with the communists and except with the jihadists. They're loving it. And you know what? We're seeing that encroachment and subversion of our liberties at home. Oh, let's see. Here's another one. Let's see. As I just go along and I do the search on the Anti-Federalist Papers or some of the Anti-Federalist Papers, and as it's talking, as many of the assessors and collectors of federal taxes will be above 300 miles from the seat of the federal government, and now this case almost 3,000 miles and further, that they will take and do what? They're going to be all over the place. Besides, to lay and collect internal taxes in this extensive country must require a great number of congressional ordinances immediately operating upon the body of the people. These must continually interfere with the state laws and thereby produce disorder and general dissatisfaction. Till the one system of laws or the other operating upon the same subjects, that's be you and me, shall be abolished. These ordinances alone, to say nothing of those respecting the militia, coin, money, commerce, federal judiciary, etc., will probably soon defeat the operations of the state laws and governments. Wow. What are we hearing? Well, Chuck Schumer says, we're going to expand the courts so that we could take and get rid of, or take and balance out all of those Trump appointees. Oh, we're going to change what the Supreme Court looks like. Wow. Oh, what are we doing on commerce? What are we doing on coinage? And wow, what's happening with the military? Interesting. All right, let's pick another one. All the references are there, all right, as to where you can specifically find these in the Federalist Papers. Oh boy, the power of repelling and forbidding the execution of any tax law, whatever, that may interfere with or impede the exercise of the general taxing power, and it would not be possible that two taxing powers should be exercised on the same sources of taxation without interfering with each other. May not the exercise of this power of Congress, when they think proper, operate not only to destroy those ministerial powers which are left with the states, but even the very forms. We're seeing that in so much that now we have this federal taxation. And now with Mr. Buttigieg, I think that's how you say his name, wanting to tax every mile that you drive because just not going to have enough money with all these electric cars. And I don't care. We're getting rid of all the gasoline because all the fracking, and already gas has gone up in a week, 20 cents a gallon, on and on. And our power bill, hey, there's a lot of us that heat with propane. Guess what? Under Obama, we're paying almost $3 a gallon for propane. It dropped to $1 and change under the Trump administration. I can see where now our heating ability is going to go higher and higher because we now cannot get fuel to take and heat our house. Natural gas, all of that. It's going to cost more. And the taxation is going to be crazy because they want to roll back various taxes. Let's see. I believe no one ever possessed it. It is a power that will immediately and extensively interfere with the internal policies of the separate states. And we're talking about establishing various laws and all of that that the federal government now has in its power and is taking, and by giving power to the union, we greatly extend the jurisdictions of the federal judiciary, as all questions arising on bankruptcy laws being laws of the union, even between citizens and states. So the interference of the courts, which we've seen over and over. Oh, here's one for you. Congress cannot interfere with the opening of rivers and canals, the making or regulation of roads, except post roads, building bridges, erecting ferries, building lighthouses, etc. In one case, which may very frequently happen, this proposition also fails. For if the river, canal, road, or bridge, ferry become of the two states or a matter in which they may be both concerned, consequently must both concur then that the interference and consent of Congress becomes absolutely necessary, since it is declared in this Constitution that, quote, no state shall, without the consent of Congress, enter into any agreement or compact with another state, period, end of quote. So, hey, executive order, here we go, XL pipeline, whoosh, because it concerns more than one state and a whole bunch of other stuff. Same with the waterways, same with all of these other regulations on water in America. A lot of stuff, folks, a lot of different things on interference. So what do we do? Well, number one, you have to secure your state. You have to work as hard as you can, and we may talk about it in a future broadcast here, on how you get the Republican Party in your state to buck up and start acting in your favor as a citizen. The other thing you need to do is understand your state constitution, and then you need to work with those that you can to have and hold the elected and the bureaucrats accountable. Can't forget those bureaucrats. Hey, Fauci, 30 years. I know of others that are 30 years making lots of money and everybody else is suffering. Okay? Our economy is driven by people being able to exercise their rights. And we'll talk about that. In fact, I'm going to be doing something on the lesser magistrate for a group of people on the 16th of February. And we're going to talk about what does it mean for your rights to stand up. And quite frankly, what's happening is that we have a violation of our God-given rights. And you need to know them. You need to understand what that means so that you can then press those that you are going to elect, even for school board. What does it mean for the rights of my children? Instead of bringing in the social emotional learning that is trying to destroy the families and leverage the immorality that is being pressed out there. Well, Samuel Adams and the anti-federalists would tell you to get not just informed, but to get active. Ensure that you're holding people accountable and that, yeah, you come back next week and Sam Adams returns.